Hello and welcome to the Extended Grid YouTube channel. I'm Greg and today we're going to be programming an NTP clock using a Pi Pico. And we're going to be using ChatGPT to do it. So stick around, we're about to get extended. So let's take a look at what our parts are for this project. So we're going to need a Pi Pico. And that's a little microcontroller built by the Raspberry Pi Foundation that allows us to be able to do the Wi-Fi connectivity, the NTP connectivity, as well as driving the display, which is an OLED display. And it's a very low power display. It's very tiny in this particular case, but it really could be a display of any size. And it would be able to drive it as long as it's of the right format and of compatible connectivity. We're also going to use a couple of programs. So obviously we're going to use ChatGPT, but in order to program the Pi Pico, we're actually going to use a program called Thonny. And Thonny just makes programming everything a lot easier. We're going to use Micropython as well, just in terms of keeping everything very simple without having to compile it and having to go through a bunch of hoops in order to get everything to work. As far as our programming requirements themselves, the Pi Pico needs to connect to the Wi-Fi. So we're also going to have our credentials in a secrets file. And this is best practice as far as programming is concerned, because you don't necessarily want your core program to have unique credentials that may need to change if you build multiple devices on multiple Wi-Fi networks. You can then just change your secrets file and keep your core program the same. And that brings us to our next one, which is the internal clock of the Pi Pico needs to be set by NTP. That way the network time is what's actually driving it, because in this particular case, the Pi Pico does not have an internal battery to be able to maintain that clock when it's powered off. So as soon as it starts up, we need to get that time synchronization from somewhere. So we're going to get it from NTP over the Wi-Fi connection. And then finally, we need the current time to show on the display itself. The clock doesn't do you much good if you can't see it. So let's go ahead and get programming. So let's come up with a prompt that we want to use in order to fulfill our requirements without having to go into a lot of detail and let ChatGPT figure it out. So let's just start with brass tacks. What are we going to be programming and what are we going to be programming on? So we're going to be using GPT-4 for this particular example, just because that is the current latest version available to us. But we have a message limit of 25 messages, so hopefully we can accommodate all of this within that span. So what I'm going to ask it is, I want to write a MicroPython program to build an NTP clock using a Pi Pico that will have Wi-Fi credentials stored in a secrets file, and the clock will output to an OLED screen. And that's exactly what our requirements are, and that's pretty much where we're going to leave it, so let's see what it says. So we see it's completed the actual output of the script, and it's just going to update every minute, but in this particular case it's actually updating every minute from NTP time. So it will always be accurate, but we actually want it to be able to run offline in the event that the network is not available. So let's update our requirements and ask it to modify the code to actually... We're going to ask it to modify the code to update the internal clock first using NTP and then update the display. We're also going to ask it to update it at the top of every minute to try and keep all of our clocks synchronized in case we had multiple. So what we just saw is that GPT output a program that would only synchronize to NTP just once, and that would be at boot time, and then it wouldn't synchronize to it again. It would just use the internal clock. And for a lot of applications, that may be fine, but over time it's going to drift, and that could be a problem. So we're going to ask it to modify the program to also update periodically from NTP to keep that time synchronized, so that way it doesn't drift over time. So we see that ChatGPT completed the program output, and it says that it's going to update it every hour, which is 3,600 seconds. So we may want to change that, but generally speaking, for most precision, especially if we're only updating it every minute, an hour is going to be just fine. You know, if it's a second off here or there, that's not really going to impact anything. If this was a more critical application, maybe we would want that to be a bit quicker, but I think we're going to do just fine. So the last thing that we want to do is the particular LCD that we're actually using is very small, and it's only 32 pixels high by 128 across. If you saw when it was programming the code, it was actually going to do 64 in height, which would make for a bigger clock. But in this particular case, let's tell it what we have, just so that way it can account for it. Perfect. So it's gone ahead and finished that code to account for the smaller display. Now, looking through this actual code, we do see that there's a couple of points of interest. Something else that's interesting is that we actually see that they manually implemented the NTP time protocol. So it's just sending a socket request and getting back some raw data and then processing it instead of including a separate library. It is actually a very simple protocol, so it is a lot more efficient to be able to do it this way than to include a bunch of extra code that we may not need. So this looks good. Let's go ahead and bring it into Thonny and try it out. So now we've loaded the script inside of Thonny. Now something else that we need is the secrets file that was mentioned when we first started. So let's go ahead and copy that in as well. So here we see the format. We would obviously have to update this with our current SSID and our password that we would need to use for this. So I'm not going to show this once, of course, I put my actual SSID and password in here, but just so you know what it looks like. Next, we're going to load MicroPython on the Pi Pico itself. To do that, there's a button located right here. We're going to hold that down while we plug it in. And what we see is it opened up the root as if it was just an external drive of the Pi Pico. So we can close out of this because we're going to use Thonny in order to load it. So we're going to open up from, we're going to click in the bottom right hand corner and we're going to do install MicroPython. That would allow us to choose the Pi Pico that we just connected, which in this case is just the drive, it shows up as drive D. We're going to choose our variant. We have the Pi Pico W, which is the wireless one with Wi-Fi. And we're just going to choose the default one. In this case, it does say it's unstable, but it's stable enough for our purposes. And we just hit install. It will then go through and it will copy the files over. And once it's done, we can reconnect our Pico. So it completed. So in order to start using it, we can close out of this. We can then unplug our Pico and we can plug it back in. Once we do that, if we click in the bottom right hand corner again, we can actually choose to use it as an interpreter to be able to check and run our script. So we're going to choose the MicroPython Raspberry Pi Pico COM3. We see it loads with the classic 3-caret prompt for Python. So now that we're all connected and everything's installed on the Pi Pico, let's go ahead and save our file to it. So we go to File, we go to Save Copy, we're going to choose Raspberry Pi Pico, and we're going to name it main.py. And we will hit OK. It's then going to load it onto our Pi Pico. So now that we have everything programmed, we should actually go ahead and solder our connections together. So we'll just do it really quick, but I'm going to solder together the four connections from the OLED display to the Pi Pico. So to connect the OLED display, we're going to connect power, ground, we're going to connect serial clock, and serial data. Now the two critical pins are pins 1 and pin 2. Pin 1 is serial data, pin 2 is serial clock. The power and ground pins are taken from the respective power and ground pins on the Pico. So those are predefined, those are not addressed pins. So we'll just go ahead and make those connections really quick. It should only take a second. So there we've completed the soldering on both sides. I'm going to pull off the protective cover just because we're going to use it in a second. But now we can proceed forward and try out the software. So now we have our Pi Pico soldered to our OLED display. But in order to drive it, we actually need one more piece of software, which is the SSD 1306 driver. If we click this and we try and run it, we see there's no module named SSD 1306. So in order to get it, let's first ask ChatGPT and just see if it has it in memory. So what it provided us with is a GitHub link to the actual file itself that we could just download. So let's go ahead and do that. Perfect. So we ran into a bit of an issue where it's not found. So how else can we find it? So we're actually just going to Google it. And we're just going to see what it comes up with. And we see it's giving us another link to a GitHub repository. It's not very long, but it carries a lot of definitions that we need in order to make this run. So let's go ahead and copy this down. So we're going to copy the raw contents. We're going to go back into Thonny and we'll create a new file and paste it there. Sometimes this is easier than trying to download it and import it. Sometimes it's not. In this particular case, this is the path that we're going with. So we will save it to the Pi Pico and we will call it SSD1306.py, which is what it was looking for. And we hit OK. So I actually had to change the pin number to 0 for SDA. SCL was pin 1 to match the wiring that we did with the soldering that we just did. And then the actual index that we had to use was 0, which is what matches these two particular pins. So now when we actually run it, we see that it says the name socket is not defined. So let's just try importing it. And we'll run it again. So we see that once we do that, we're able to connect up and we're able to see the expected output. Now in this case, the time zone is not correct, but it does demonstrate that we're able to create a clock that's able to synchronize from NTP. I think the time zone set is a bit outside of the scope since we would have to implement it manually. So there we have it. We have our Pi Pico and our NTP clock operating as expected, updating off of Wi-Fi and displaying the time on the OLED display. So hopefully that whets your appetite in terms of what's possible with microcontrollers like the Pi Pico. There's really a world of possibilities and it's very variable in terms of whatever you want to do with it, you can, as long as you can program it, and ChatGPT makes it a lot easier to be able to do that. If you'd like to see more videos as part of our AI exploration series, check out this playlist right here. Also, if you like the video, be sure to hit that like button and leave a comment down below. If you haven't subscribed, please subscribe and then hit that notification bell. That way you know the next time we're getting extended. So until then, take care.